Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Power to the People by Laura Ingraham, narrated by the author and directed by June Miller. This book is copyrighted 2007 by Laura Ingraham. This recording is copyrighted 2007 by Recorded Books. Top-rated radio personality Laura Ingraham is fed up with the rules of the elites, and Power to the People issues a call to arms, a plea to reinvigorate our birthright of liberty, to reconnect to our American heritage, and to revive our commitment to traditional, conservative principles. And now, Power to the People.
It's nighttime in America, or at least it feels that way. Frustration, anger, confusion. These emotions ambush us whenever we stop to consider how estranged we have become from politics and the culture. We're like strangers in a foreign land. We feel there's nowhere to turn for help, no safe harbor where our values are protected. We have few leaders willing to represent and fight for those values. We see our country veering so off course in so many areas that we feel powerless to turn it around. It can all seem overwhelming and demoralizing. Kind of like a Nancy Pelosi speech. Well, whether you know it or not, many of the most important choices of your life are being made for you. They're being made by out-of-touch politicians, agenda-driven educrats, haughty life-tenure judges, and executives in a polluted entertainment industry, all of whom believe that they know better than you. Responsibility and accountability are principles they preach but do not practice. They have their agendas, and when the little people get in the way, well, watch out. They are perpetrating a massive power grab. Watch your wallet, hide your children, lock up the livestock. They're coming for you. How do we reclaim the power that is rightfully ours? If you've ever listened to my radio show, you'll remember that at the end of the introductory soundbite montage, a scratchy, shrill-sounding woman screeches, "Power to the people!" Those mellifluous tones belong to a self-styled urban human rights activist, translation, leftist with a bullhorn, named Effia Nwangaza. For her, power to the people really means power to the Marxists, socialists, anti-war activists, international bureaucracies, non-governmental organizations, and illegal alien umbrella groups. It's power over the people who are too busy working and taking care of their families to join the protest culture. Americans who work hard, pick up the tab, and make this country what it is. Real power to the people. During the 1960s, Vietnam protesters and John Imagine No Religion Lenin used the phrase as a battle cry of rebellion against their elders, the establishment. 40 years later, they've become the establishment. And just look at what their rebellion hath wrought. Years ago, I made an executive decision to take the phrase, power to the people, away from those who never really meant it. For decades, the American left tried to convince us that their agenda was all about empowerment. There was women power, and black power, and gray power, and rainbow power, and now there's even green power. We were encouraged to revel in free love and to take a free ride, courtesy of all those fools who did the 9-to-5 thing. For all their empowerment and anti-establishment blather, what they really meant was they were more than happy to help themselves to positions of power and influence. In the meantime, they made the nation a slave to fringe groups, political correctness, expanding bureaucracies, and our own consumerism. They worked feverishly to move more decision-making to Washington, taking power from the people and giving it to bureaucrats and politicians who want to spend our money, make our decisions, and tie us all up in red tape. So much for empowerment. They have us right where they want us. Now, someone out there will inevitably say, "Wait a minute, Laura. Liberalism has been in the decline for most of our recent political history. Isn't there some Republican blame to go around?" To some extent, yes, we are all to blame. Yet it is undeniable that the American left has been at the controls of our culture for most of our lives, dominating academia, the courts, the media, and Hollywood. Most Americans were too busy earning an honest living, raising their children, and going to church to notice what was slowly happening around them, or they thought there was nothing that they could do to stop it. With liberalism rejected at the ballot box, they assumed that elected representatives would live up to their pledges to protect and defend the country and our way of life. But too often, the same politicians who claimed to be for the people turned against us, our principles, and our dreams. Their power to the people movement was a scam. It's time to take our power back. Rights? What rights? Our Declaration of Independence reminds us of the unalienable rights that are ours to enjoy. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. These rights are dependent upon one another for survival. We often forget that we have been endowed with these rights by our Creator. How seldom we think of Him and our duty to Him as we exercise these precious rights. In this age of widespread human embryo destruction, abortion and euthanasia, and even cloning, how can we credibly protect the right to life? What is liberty? How do we exercise it without encroaching on the rights of others? And what does it mean to pursue happiness? Is that just a permission slip to indulge our every appetite? Is it a free pass to supersize our meals, wallow in porn, and swell our coffers regardless of the impact on others? No. The Founding Fathers did not risk their lives, their fortunes, and their sacred honor so we could become spoiled, pampered, narcissistic, and focus solely on our own pleasure. An ordered society was the Founders' goal. A place where we could live our lives in limitless possibility, but only if we fulfilled our obligations. They wanted us to have the liberty to tap into our creative powers for our own good and for the good of our countrymen. This is the pathway to true happiness, but that society is only possible if we, the people, have a shared set of values, a common set of beliefs that bind us together. The Founders did not view liberty as a license, but as a sacred responsibility to be used for the good. Too often, we have sought power in the wrong places, mistaking freedom for the free rein to do whatever we want, whenever we want. That anything-goes mentality is not empowering, it's enslaving. Your power flows from the freedom you have to make your own choices, the right choices, virtuous choices. Freedom must be informed, guided by what's right, in order for us to live joyful, fulfilling lives, and for the Republic to survive. When we act irresponsibly, when we act selfishly, when we're lazy or weak, that's when we're most likely to give away our power. And experts are ever ready to impose their own brand of order, set up their own course for the future, and make sure you march in lockstep. The more power we give the elites, the more they become the rulers, and we become the ruled. The good news is it's never too late. Although we've been pushed to the edge of the ravine, we can still save ourselves, but only if we face the reality and defend ourselves. It's time to acknowledge that our cultural and political leaders have failed us, and that we allowed this to happen. Here's where things stand. Family matters. The American family is besieged by a hostile culture, destructive government policies, and by our own selfishness. Under attack from all sides, the traditional family is now regarded as just another social arrangement, no better than any other. Despite every statistic showing that traditional family life is the healthiest for us and for the future of the society, the dominant culture continues to degrade its significance. Individualism is wonderful, but individuals without families are lost. Families are a true source of power. Don't fence me out. Facilitated by a well-funded alliance of Latino and business lobbies and by elites in both parties, illegals have crashed our borders in unprecedented numbers. 6 years after September 11th, this is a national disgrace. By now, illegal aliens have received the message loud and clear. Crime does pay, especially when it involves our immigration laws. Americans and legal residents are fed up with politicians who want to write new laws to fix the problem when the government doesn't enforce the immigration laws already on the books. Our national power and identity comes in part from our shared American culture and language. This power will continue to be eaten away if we don't stop the double talk and defend our borders. Falling off the learning curve. It has been said many times that learning is power. Shaping the minds of future generations is one of the most important responsibilities that parents and teachers have. Unfortunately, we've been bullied into relinquishing our children to bloated bureaucracies, second-rate Marxist intellectuals, and legions of education experts. The old emphasis on excellence and merit has been swallowed up by ideologically biased curricula and politically correct teaching methods that are shortchanging our students and our country. In many of our universities, things are even bleaker. There is a total lack of ideological diversity on most college faculties, or at best, the diversity ranges from Howard Dean liberals to spittle-fleck Marxists. If a professor is criticized for abusing his taxpayer-funded classroom by propagandizing against America rather than teaching his presumed subject, he hides behind the tattered old veil of academic freedom. Why don't these faculties just get it over with and start offering majors in anti-Americanism? What a great way to spend $45,000 a year. America first. America must be defended and vigorously. While it may be impossible to prevent every future attack, Americans must believe that our government is doing all it can to protect the homeland. That means we should not squander our military power on what are largely humanitarian, aka nation-building missions. The interests of America and our own security must always come first and guide our foreign policy. Our military is overstretched, underfunded, and approaching the breaking point. And not to ruin your day, but China is well on its way to becoming the next global superpower. Take back that gavel. Anytime the elites can take decisions away from the people and entrust them to unelected judges, they will. When judges wade into controversial social issues that are best left to the voters, we all lose. On issues from abortion to profanity on television, we are being disenfranchised from our own political system. It's reasonable to ask why we should even bother writing to our congressmen or voting for elected representatives when, on any critical issue, all it takes is five life-tenure justices on the Supreme Court to overturn the will of the people. In just the last few years, the court has eroded our property rights, banished the Ten Commandments from courthouses, and begun micromanaging the war on terror. But what do they care? They answer to no one. They have lifetime job security, summers off, and a never-ending supply of boondoggle speaking gigs. Who would want to retire with those perks? As we go about our busy lives, the courts are busy siphoning power away from us and our elected representatives. The Supremes often seem more worried about the feelings of the New York Times editorial board than they are about offending the intent of the framers or the will of the people. Your new media lifeline. The internet, talk radio, and cable television busted the monopoly of left-wing elites who had been our self-appointed information gatekeepers for decades. They knew the stories they reported, or chose not to report, could profoundly affect the views of Americans. All the news that's fit to print, that's the way it is. They were telling us little people what they thought we should know. Conservatives, meanwhile, had only National Review and a few other journals to turn to for intellectual nourishment. So it was a relief when the media elite's stranglehold was broken by one man. 20 years ago, radio host Rush Limbaugh hit the airwaves and connected with Americans who were sick of Dan Rather, fed up with the New York Times, and bored to death by Bill Moyers. The first time I heard the Rush Limbaugh show, I thought, finally! His informative and entertaining approach to the news and political fights of the day spawned an entire industry, including the Laura Ingraham show, that now reaches tens of millions of Americans every day. But don't take any of our shows for granted. At this very moment, ambitious and embittered Democrats, frustrated by the flameout of Air America, are plotting ways to silence conservative talk radio. And you know if they could figure out a way to shut down conservative blogs, they'd do that too. Stay tuned for more details. keeping it local. Our ability to influence is greatest when decisions are made closest to home. Think about it. Your assemblyman votes to increase your state sales tax. In protest, you can pick it outside his office. Heck, you can walk into his office and give him a piece of your mind. But when Congress passes a tax hike, your complaints are handled by 23-year-old Hill staffers who'd rather be hitting the bars and surfing YouTube. And letters to the editor only go so far. Trying to reach Washington from Duluth is like trying to reach around Ted Kennedy at the Senate dining room buffet line. It's no wonder, then, that so many local and state decisions have been hijacked by the feds, and it's only getting worse. Blinding us with science. Scientists and medical researchers have added immeasurably to the length and quality of our lives. The vast majority have dedicated themselves to the development of innovative treatments and technologies to eradicate deadly diseases and generally advance the cause of human life. These are noble goals. Nevertheless, it is up to us to establish moral and ethical boundaries to ensure that we are not throwing our humanity out with a petri dish. Are we really so fearful of being branded anti-progress and heartless that we won't speak up against runaway science when we know we should? Let's be honest. A lot of what our culture is doing in the name of science is really being done out of vanity. We don't want to die. Not today, not tomorrow, not ever. And even if we do live to a ripe old age, we don't want to look like it. Whatever happened to the entire concept of aging gracefully? Meg Ryan went from cute to scary with what she did to herself. And some politicians' faces have been pulled so tight, it's a wonder they can close their eyes at night. Exactly what is empowering about giving ourselves butt lifts and pec implants and our 16-year-old daughter's boob jobs? And let's not forget about the designer baby craze sweeping Europe and growing ever more popular here, which promises families the perfect child. Aldous Huxley, call your office. The culture clash. You know it, and I know it. Girls and boys have gone wild. It's both the fault of the sex-saturated media circus and permissive parenting. Even hands-on parents are having trouble stemming the tide of cultural sewage seeping into their homes on a daily basis. They feel as though they can no longer shape their children's values against a culture arrayed against them on virtually every TV show, every popular song, every popular movie, and even the neighborhood school. Pornography is a $30 billion industry in America and is making multimillionaires of sicko producers, twisted directors, and pathetic actors, who have now made inroads into the mainstream culture. Their influence can now be seen in the sad streetwalker antics of Paris Hilton, Britney Spears, and all their various imitators. What is Tara Reid's talent? Even conservative media outlets dip into the porn pond in their coverage of such pressing questions as whether Anna Nicole Smith's artificial breasts would decompose at the same rate as the rest of her natural body. This is absolute madness. So why are we watching this trash? And how is it reshaping the future of America? Reaching higher ground. In the end, we need to face the most important truth. There is no chance that we will prevail in any of these battles if we don't retain our belief in God. God is the engine that drives all we do. And faith in God is the foundation of the Republic and any healthy society. Every decision, from how we treat the grocery store clerk to how we treat the government of Iran, will be greatly influenced by our beliefs. What good is returning power to the people if it's not the power to do good? And what better way is there to foster this spirit than through faith? It is faith which calls us to be self-sacrificial and to love others that has made us a great nation. Every now and again, we have to ask ourselves, what's the point of this thing called America anyway? Is the point to make as much money as possible in our lifetimes? Is this nation called to some higher purpose? Are we living the way God wants us to live? And if not, why not? What is life all about? There are plenty of people in our country who think these questions absurd. These are usually the same people who cheer every time the ACLU files a lawsuit to remove a cross on public land. Whether it's evicting baby Jesus statues from manger scenes at Christmas or forbidding the menorah from being lit at a public park during Hanukkah, there exists a pronounced anti-religious fervor in the left liberal culture that has been imposed upon a predominantly religious America. Every other week, a magazine, a book, or a television documentary asserts some new discovery that attempts to prove that Jesus Christ and his followers either didn't exist or were actually quite happy with sexual promiscuity and summered at Lake Como. On television and in film, faithful people, traditional Christians, are portrayed as wild-eyed zealots or members of dangerous secret cults. When was the last time you saw a member of NOW or PETA depicted that way? The goal of the elites is to drive religious voices from the public square. They want to erode traditional religious faith and make you feel goofy or backward or out of line when you offer a religious perspective on public policy or cultural issues. They want you to shut up about God so the secularists can monopolize the public discourse and public policy. We can't let that happen. Our Judeo-Christian tradition has done more good for America and the rest of the world than liberal secularists ever will. We have a lot of work to do. We must shake off our lethargy and reconnect with our American heritage. What follows is a call to arms. We need to fight for our culture, for our country. We need to revive our understanding of traditional conservative principles, the true empowerment agenda. As we focus much of our attention on the Islamic terrorists and enemy states, we cannot lose sight of what is happening here at home. I will expose the threats we face from an emboldened cultural left, from the global liberal elite, from science worshipers, and from politicians who spend more time on their hair than serving their constituents. I will offer solutions for how we can use our power individually and together to pursue life, liberty, and true happiness. The purpose of this book is not just to rile you up. I do that every day on the radio. The goal is to incite you to do your part to protect the country that we love. It is ours to lose. And there are many here and abroad who are more than willing to take it from us. Let's get to work. There is no time to lose. We are up to the task, and we will be stronger for having fought the good fight. And if we remember what our founding fathers knew, that God is with us, and that with Him everything is possible, we will never lose heart. We will prevail. Power to the people. Chapter 1, Power to the Family. I hope all those kids aren't hers, a woman standing a few people behind me in line whispered to her friend. They both looked to be in their 40s, each with a small child in tow. They were well-dressed in that preppy, quilted jacket-wearing weekend sort of way. No way, they can't all be hers, the friend gasped, oblivious to the fact that I could hear everything. Can you imagine having that many? Forget it. I was in line with six children, ages 5 to 13, to see Shrek 2, having volunteered to take them to the movie to give their parents a break one Sunday. The six, three boys and three girls, hailed from a family of eight. They were eager to get their popcorn and their Twizzlers and get into their seats, but otherwise well-behaved. After the forget it line, I couldn't stop myself from turning around to confront these women. Anything I can help you with, ladies? I asked. These suburban housewives were caught off guard and pretended they didn't understand what I was saying. I repeated myself. Finally, the brunette meekly said, "You have such a lovely family." I answered that they were not mine, but that my friend Becky, their mother, was pregnant with her ninth child. The two women just stood there uncomfortably, with frozen half-smiles, slightly nodding their heads. Until that moment, I didn't realize the extent to which the dominant culture frowns on big families. Maybe this is because I don't have any children myself, but in talking to my friends with large families, I've learned that the reaction in many quarters to parents with 5, 7, or 9 children today falls somewhere between shock and revulsion. The comments run the gamut. How does that mother have the time? She must never sleep. And my personal favorite? That's so selfish. The popular culture generally portrays people with large families as freaks, relics of a bygone age to be studied by sociologists in a laboratory somewhere. In case you're wondering, the Waltons and their seven kids are no longer part of the cultural in-crowd. If the TV show 8 is Enough were produced today, it would have to be called 2 is Enough, just so everyone would feel comfortable. In an April 2007 episode of the ABC television drama Brothers and Sisters, 40-something Kitty Walker, played by Calista Flockhart, and her mother, Sally Fields, run into old family rivals, the Joneses, also mother and daughter, at lunch. Kitty's contemporary, Lizzie, played by Jenna Elfman, is pregnant, and her mom beams that it's her fifth child. A look of total shock comes over Kitty's face. Five? Five? Are you kidding me? Five? Really? She remarks nervously to Lizzie and then adds, well, it's just that five seems so normal when we were growing up, but now it just seems so surreal. The Joneses were portrayed as annoying, cookie-cutter perfect country club types. Lizzie comes off as a ditzy mother, while Kitty is a single, professional brainiac. This reinforces what the culture has told us all along. Smart women would never be so stupid as to be tied down with five kids today. So surreal. The hand that rocks the cradle. It didn't happen overnight, but when it comes to family issues, the fringe has become the mainstream, and the mainstream has become the fringe. A few generations ago, it was not that uncommon for families to feature as many as 10 children. In fact, in the 1960s, Rose Kennedy and her daughter-in-law, Ethel, wife of Bobby, were getting style points for having 9 and 11 children, respectively. From Time magazine, October 21, 1966. I just love big families, Ethel Kennedy, 38, is fond of saying. That is fortunate. She and Bobby are expecting their 10th in the spring. These days, having such a large family earns you strange glances, shocked reactions, and castigations from environmentalists and anti-population growth wackos. Somehow, being fruitful and multiplying is considered self-indulgent by those who put a high value on attaining a certain lifestyle for themselves and later for their children. These people consider it selfish for adults to devote themselves to supporting a large family, but it is apparently unselfish to spend your money on a lifestyle made up of frequent and exotic vacations, state-of-the-art gadgets, spa treatments, golf lessons, club memberships, boarding schools, and summer camps. If you can follow that logic, please explain it to me. Wait a minute, you may be asking yourself, I thought this was a book about politics, about empowering the people. What does the debate about large versus small families have to do with power? Everything. Families are where it all starts for us, and the way we treat families tells us where we're headed as a society. Whether we are open to children and welcome them joyfully into our families says a lot about how we think about our future. What I heard in that theater, and what we see in the culture every day, is a lack of respect for families and parental authority. True, we hear a lot from the political and cultural left about the children. They endlessly lecture the rest of America about what the children want and need. Higher taxes are for the children. Greenhouse gas limits are for the children. Government-controlled health care is for the children. Public acceptance of all types of social behavior, an excuse for boorishness. Manner of dress, slovenly and slutty. And language, foul, helps the children keep an open mind. Oh, and I almost forgot, relaxed immigration laws are for the children of Mexico. Whether parents know it or not, there is a cultural battle raging right now for the hearts and minds of their children. The cultural and political left in America understands that whoever controls our children controls the future. The left talks about children as a collective class, the children, like the workers. Oftentimes, beautiful little children are used as mere political props by both parties. Who can forget how San Francisco Congresswoman Nancy Pelosi used dozens of children as her backdrop when she was sworn in as the first female Speaker of the House? Yeah, she was taking the gavel for the children, all right. Families don't view their offspring in this way, as political tools, or as a future voting bloc. For parents and for siblings, there is no the children. There are only specific children, very real individual children, who smile and cry in their own way, experience heartbreak and joy in their own way, and who have their own personal strengths and weaknesses. Each child is unique, and each must be loved and nurtured according to his or her own needs. But bureaucracy and politicians with big government plans for the children can't see individual children. Like the character in the great Russian novel, The Brothers Karamazov, who realizes, the more I love humanity in general, the less I love man in particular. The more our politicians love the children, the less they seem to want and care for actual children. The worst but logical expression of this cultural failing is the claim that it is wrong to bring children into this horrible world we have created. Wrong again. You don't make the world better by eliminating the most precious ingredient, children. Families not only reflect who we are, they show us who we will be. Perhaps the greatest power you have, the greatest power any of us have, is the power to pass along our beliefs, values, and traditions to a child. This is not a new thought. While you may not have heard of the 19th century American poet William Ross Wallace, I'll bet you've heard the last two lines of this excerpt from his most famous poem. Infancy's the tender fountain, power may with beauty flow, mothers first to guide the streamlets, from them souls unresting grow. Grow on for the good or evil, sunshine streamed or evil hurled, for the hand that rocks the cradle is the hand that rules the world. This is poetry that speaks a truism. Those people who pass along their values to the next generation have a disproportionate effect on the future. In 2005, Foreign Policy magazine published a striking article that discussed these themes in some detail. The news was not promising for the secular left. It noted that in the United States, the percentage of women born in the late 1930s who remained childless was near 10%. On the other hand, nearly 20% of women born in the late 50s have not had children. The author pointed out that the greatly expanded segment of contemporary society whose members are drawn disproportionately from the feminist and countercultural movements of the 1960s and 70s will leave no genetic legacy, nor will their emotional or psychological influence on the next generation compare with that of their parents. Thank God for small miracles. According to the article, 17.4% of baby boomer women had only one child. But these children account for only 7.8% of the next generation. By contrast, only 11% of baby boomer women had four or more children. Those children account for almost 25% of the next generation. The article concludes that these trends are pushing American society to the right. This dynamic helps explain, for example, the gradual drift of American culture away from secular individualism and toward religious fundamentalism. Among states that voted for President George W. Bush in 2004, fertility rates are 12% higher than in states that voted for Senator John Kerry. It may also help to explain the increasing popular resistance among rank-and-file Europeans to such crown jewels of secular liberalism as the European Union. It turns out that Europeans who are most likely to identify themselves as world citizens are also those least likely to have children. It doesn't take Stephen Hawking to understand that the more children you have to whom you can pass on your cultural, religious, and political values, the more likely your values will survive into the future. So far, conservatives have done an admirable job of resisting the pressure that discourages many young Americans from creating families. And as a result, our influence and our power has grown. Contrary to what so many feminists told a generation of women, families are actually quite liberating. The stronger your family is, the more independent you can be. A family that sticks together and helps each other is also more likely to survive economic downturns, less likely to need government-provided health care, and less likely to need daycare. Its children will be better prepared for school, and its grandparents will be better prepared for retirement. At every stage of life, its members will have more freedom and be less dependent on government or other large institutions than people who lack family support. So if we really want to empower the average person, the best thing we can do is to strengthen families. Unfortunately, there are powerful forces at work trying to undermine families in America today. In particular, there are cultural forces attacking the very concept of the family and government policies placing families at a disadvantage. Behind the anti-child bias. Back to those carping women at the theater. Their comments reflect a view in our society today that is all too common. That there is something wrong or even slightly wicked about large families. Given how unusual such families are these days, what difference does it make whether the elites approve of them or not? The reason is simple. Large families are a test of how you feel about families in general. If you believe something is good, you want it to grow. Businessmen want their companies to be as big as possible. Bureaucrats want their bureaucracies to be as big as possible. And Ted Kennedy wants his Tumblr to be as big as possible. So why does the bigger is better ethos only apply to less important things like hamburgers or house size? Doubts about big families really represent doubts about all families. Some people argue that small clans are better because they enable parents to give more attention to each child, but this argument often reflects doubts about the willingness of parents to raise and love more than a few children, and it ignores how much children learn from their siblings. Others may say that small families are better because they are more stable financially. But only the most hard-hearted skeptic could really believe that another SUV or an annual cruise to Bermuda is worth more than a child. Yes, families, like most good things in life, require sacrifice. But even the headache of a second mortgage, the indignity of hand-me-downs, and the blandness of store-brand cereal for breakfast every morning are fair prices to pay for parents and children of large families. Others say we need fewer children to avoid harming the environment. Once again, however, this argument criticizes all parents, not just the ones with large families. It also betrays a view that humans are simply consumers. The fact is, people are producers, too. And it is human creativity, not barrenness, that drives progress, including improving the environment. Let me be clear. I am not saying large families are better than small families. My point is simply that the real reason that large families make so many people uncomfortable is that families make people uncomfortable. Families are bad for you. The modern mind does not view families as the fundamental building blocks of a free society, but rather as a threat to individual liberty. That's because service to others is viewed as enslaving, while service to self as the highest ideal. We know the opposite is true. The family as an institution has been under attack for a very long time. Over 100 years ago, Henrik Ibsen's play The Doll's House argued that intelligent women were oppressed by traditional family roles. George Bernard Shaw in his play Mrs. Warren's Profession tried to make the point that a woman engaged in prostitution was freer than a married woman, and that both use sex to get what they need from men. Over 50 years ago, playwrights like Tennessee Williams, Arthur Miller, and Eugene O'Neill were packing Broadway theaters with dramas about dysfunctional families and the tormented children that they produced. This family equals slavery storyline went from being avant-garde in Ibsen's day to being cliché today. Yet the entertainment industry is still spewing out anti-family drivel. Recent movies and TV shows, from Imaginary Heroes to Weeds, have portrayed the so-called typical suburban family as a cesspool of every conceivable vice, from avarice to envy to lust. And let's not forget Sigmund Freud. He and his followers trace countless psychological problems to the family, and many modern psychologists and psychiatrists are still wild about Freud. This flood of suspicion and criticism directed at the family and promoted by the elites for generation after generation has certainly had a major effect on how we view families. The emotionally abusive father, the cold and distant mother, the hapless aunts and uncles, these stock characters in subtle but powerful ways have affected not only how we think about families, but how we operate within them. Though there were a smattering of positive depictions of family life in the 70s, 80s, and 90s on television, other nastier fare eventually swept in. The venal antics of married with children, complete with a lecherous father, a tarted-up mother, and foul-mouthed kids, became a mega hit for Fox. Now we're awash in the randy doings of the desperate housewives of Wisteria Lane. And if you look closely at today's glut of forensic shows and crime dramas, dysfunctional parents and crazy relatives are everywhere. A friend of mine recently suggested that I check out the cable channel Lifetime for even more disturbing depictions of family life in America. I regret having followed his tip. If you're a woman who believes that every man is either two-timing you, three-timing you, or is a homicidal lunatic just itching to cut you into pieces, Lifetime is your network. In between reruns of The Golden Girls and Will and Grace, Lifetime runs wall-to-wall movies with plots that follow an all-too-familiar pattern. The first movie I caught was titled Lethal Vows. This 1999 movie starring John Ritter tells the tale of a seemingly good doctor whose second wife dies mysteriously. It is up to the first wife to expose him as a murderer, proving, I guess, that three is more than company. It can be downright deadly. As part of Lifetime's Men Are Bastards theme week, it featured the film Black and Blue, based on the hit novel by Anna Quinlan. In this winter, a woman named Fran is physically and verbally abused by her detective husband. The abusers are always in law enforcement or the military. Now, why would that be? The deranged sleuth eventually tracks down his runaway bride. I don't want to ruin the ending. Total garbage. Lifetime doesn't only showcase bad old movies, but it makes original stinkers too, like The Staircase Murders. This one, starring Treat Williams as a best-selling author, concerns yet another loving husband and father who pushes his wife down the stairs just for fun. Per usual, this film is based on a true story. Everything on Lifetime is based on a true story, while being only marginally true. One of the newest original offerings on Lifetime is called Army Wives. It's a desperate housewives during wartime. How inspiring. Look, I have nothing against escapist thrillers or over-the-top domestic dramas, but how many times can you watch a woman marry Prince Charming only to wake up next to Ted Bundy? The overarching theme of this type of entertainment is that men, especially husbands, are out to get you. They lie, they cheat, they steal, they abuse you. And if you don't cap the guy during breakfast, he may well push you down the stairs. So, the best answer? Swear off marriage and family. If any other group was consistently defamed in this way, there would be protests and calls for executives to resign. But fathers are maligned and it's no big deal. It is worth asking whether the cumulative effect of these depictions undermines confidence in stable, loving marriages. Or heck, even encourages men to be abusive bums. After taking in a day's worth of this garbage, I was ready to throw myself down the stairs. Parenting 101. It's not about you anymore. From everything I have observed in my friends' families, being a good parent is not a life on the red carpet marked by champagne wishes and caviar dreams. It's more about sippy cup spills and leaky huggies. Mothers I know today are juggling so much. Many of my friends decided that work and young children were just too much to handle. Although there are plenty of moms who don't have a choice about whether to work or not, I do not know a single mom who regrets her decision to stay home during her children's formative years. Debbie, Melinda, and Sue, my mom meters, all tell me that there is no substitute for being there for their kids. A large federally funded study lends support to this view. Its findings indicate that children younger than kindergarten age who spend more time in childcare are more likely to have behavioral problems through the sixth grade. The National Institute of Child Health and Human Development has tracked 1,300 children and linked aggressive, antisocial conduct to the amount of time that they spent in non-maternal childcare. Feminists who decades ago told women they could have it all, work, family, left-wing volunteer work, were not thinking about their children. As Wendy always tells me of her children, ages 5 and 7, children don't want to have it all. They want their mom and dad. Unfortunately, today we have an explosion of PlayStation parenting. Instead of focusing on our children, too many modern parents focus on themselves. They outsource their parenting responsibilities to nannies, the television, computers, and yes, video games, anything to keep their kids occupied while they focus on their own goals. Other couples are limiting the size of their families or not having families at all because children are so expensive. Somehow, prior generations managed to maintain larger families with much less money and much smaller closets. How did they do it? The statistics tell the story. According to the Rutgers National Marriage Project in 1970, 73.6% of women ages 25 to 29 had already begun childbearing and had at least one minor child of their own. By 2000, the share of such women was only 48.7%. Childrearing is no longer the defining experience of adult life. Author of the Rutgers report, Barbara Defoe Whitehead, wrote, "Parents today feel out of sync with the larger adult world." Equally disturbing, we're now seeing the rise of so-called hipster parents. These moms and dads, in the words of columnist David Brooks, turn their babies into fashion-forward, anti-corporate, indie infants in order to stay one step ahead of the cool police. In some of the trendier parts of the country, certain parents are trying very hard, too hard, to show that even if you're a parent, you can still be hip. They even have their own online magazine, Babbel.com, for the new urban parent. Brooks' description nails it. Babbel is a normal parental advice magazine submerged under geological layers of attitudinizing. There are articles about products from the alternative industrial complex, early 60s retro baby food organizers. There's a blog from a rock star mom. It's lonely on the road. There's a column by LA's Rebecca Wolf, a sort of Silver Lake Irma Bombeck. Who says becoming a mom means succumbing to laser tattoo removal and moving to the suburbs? Yeah, nothing's cooler than a mom with a tattoo. Again, the sad thing here is that this is all self-focused. It has nothing to do with what's good for the child and has everything to do with a bizarre obsession with an immature self-image that is often harmful to the child. These new urban parents are spending so much time and energy trying to be cool that they are ignorant of the fact that one of the biggest problems facing families these days is what the American Psychological Association, APA, calls the sexualization of girls. A recent APA report criticizes the sexed-up content of the music and images that are marketed to young girls and finds a connection between turning young girls into eye candy and eating disorders, low self-esteem, and depression in girls and women. As I discuss in more detail in Chapter 6, the extraordinary levels of pornography in this culture are a big problem. But a recent article by Judith Warner in the New York Times also pointed out that too many mothers are so worried about their own sexiness that they're setting a bad example for their daughters. Their focus is on the self, as in themselves, and specifically on their sexuality. Warner contends that these women feel sexually underappreciated, so they jump at the chance to take pole dancing classes and strip aerobic sessions at their health club, which supposedly bestows upon them a new kind of erotic identity. These new evening antics of the erstwhile book club set are supposed to be fabulous because they give sexless moms a new kind of erotic identity. But what a disaster they really are. An admission that we failed utterly as adult women to figure out what it means to look and feel sexy with dignity. We've created an aesthetic void. Should we be surprised that stores like Limited 2 are rushing in to fill it? Now on sale, a t-shirt with two luscious cherries and the slogan, Double Trouble. If you've seen The Graduate, you know that sexed up moms are hardly a new thing. But it's difficult to imagine even Mrs. Robinson taking a pole dancing class in the name of fitness. By raising these points, I do not intend to be too hard on parents. As I will discuss later, parents have a more difficult job today than they did 30 plus years ago when the culture itself didn't work so hard against them. I am not a parent. And believe me, I think parenting is the most important challenge anyone can undertake. I marvel at those who do it well against tough odds. We should support a culture that reinforces that notion. My friend Stephen, who has four young children with his wife Beth, said to me once, when you become a parent, the hard thing for a lot of us men is that we really have to come to terms with the fact that the days of being cool are behind us. Of course, now I understand what most fathers and mothers understand. Raising healthy, productive, moral children is beyond cool. When I'm sitting in the back of church on Sundays, I love watching moms and dads tending to their fidgety, goofy, sleepy children. These are beautiful moments. When I was 25, squirmy and talky children in these settings bothered me. Not anymore. Today, I see it all as life-affirming. A priest friend of mine once told me about the sorts of things that drive couples with children to the brink, and at the top of the list was a failure to sacrifice for the children. He told me about one 30-something father who was feeling cheated, that he was losing his own identity with all the demands of family life. The response to him from my priest friend was blunt. The time you spend with your children may prevent you from having the promotion you've always wanted, may force you to sacrifice friendships and hobbies that you've wanted to pursue. But this is what you must do. You are their father, and the relationship you have with these children will affect them for the rest of their lives. Everybody is a family. Does it really matter what a family looks like? Are two parents, a mom and a dad, better than one? Today, it's not politically correct to answer yes to that question. The old cultural critics, from Henrik Ibsen to Eugene O'Neill, could at least agree on a common definition of family: a mother, a father, and their children. Grandparents, aunts, and uncles, and cousins are all basic relationships that were known to the ancients. For the most part, the definition of a family has been unchanged since at least the rise of Christianity almost 2,000 years ago. In recent years, the traditional definition of the family has given way to more of an anything-goes way of thinking. There are a whole raft of after-school specials and made-for-TV movies pushing the idea that any group of people who love each other should be considered a family. True to form, HBO is on the cutting edge here. In 2005, it launched a new series called Big Love, about a polygamous man, his three wives, and seven children. HBO's website describes the characters in Big Love as just another suburban family trying to live the American dream. Economic arrangements are and should be distinct from marriages ordained by God and recognized by government. Marriage exists for many of us as a sacrament. That some married people have civil ceremonies does not alter the fact that the word marriage is a lifelong commitment before God between one man and one woman. This question is not ultimately about straight, gay, polygamist, or single people. It is about advancing an agreed-upon societal norm that furthers the interests of children and therefore society. What is in the best interest of couples is all well and good, but our societal focus must be upon the welfare of children, the future of our country. As David Blankenhorn, author of the book The Future of Marriage, has written, "Marriage is fundamentally about the needs of children. And what children need most are mothers and fathers. Not caregivers, not parent-like adults, not even parents. What a child wants and needs more than anything else are the mother and the father who together made the child, who love the child and who love each other. The whole point of marriage is to bind a woman and a man together for the purpose, or at least the possibility, of begetting and nurturing children. This intimate institution is also quite public because it is a public pronouncement of what matters most: creating more healthy, loved, well-informed citizens. Your wedding vows are not just promises to one another. They are oaths to God, to your extended families, and to the community. Most important, on a practical level, they are a promise to your children. The traditional family is the best incubator of our future. All of us come from families, and the most ideal family for a child is one that consists of a married mother and father. Study after study demonstrates that this traditional family is healthy for children. Kids reared in traditional families are more likely to enjoy warm relationships with both parents, less likely to divorce or become unwed parents themselves, more likely to be successful in school and graduate from college, more likely to be healthy, less likely to abuse substances, less likely to experience child abuse, less likely to commit crimes. There exists between a man and a woman a complementarity that benefits children. Studies demonstrate that mothers devote special attention to their children's physical and emotional needs, whereas fathers devote their primary efforts to character traits. This creates an efficient, balanced, human child-rearing regime. Now, I realize that not everyone, due to circumstances beyond their control, can have both mom and dad in the house. Children can be raised successfully without either mother or father, but the exception to the rule should not displace the rule. The rule is by necessity, like all general rules of society, based on the wisdom of centuries. There are heroic examples of single mothers and fathers struggling to give their children all they have, and they're succeeding. They need our support and our prayers. But the ideal, and I think many of those single parents would agree, is to have two parents at home, preferably the two people who brought the child into the world. Despite the fact that half of all marriages end in divorce and that some people fail to reach the ideal, that ideal must be defended and promoted. We can't risk our children on anything less. The words of the most vocal activists for alternative family arrangements reveal their true disdain for the institution of marriage. Judith Stacy, a professor of sociology at New York University, believes redefining marriage is long overdue. In her journal article, Good Riddance to the Family, she argues, "If we begin to value the meaning and quality of intimate bonds over the customary forms, there are few limits to the kinds of marriage and kinship patterns people might wish to devise." Give Professor Stacy her way and we might all be seeing much bigger love at a justice of the peace near you. NYU seems to be an incubator of this sort of mushy-headed thinking. Ellen Willis, the head of NYU's Center for Cultural Reporting and Criticism, wrote of her hope that the debate over marriage would result in an implicit revolt against the institution of marriage into the very heart, further promoting the democratization and secularization of personal and sexual life. This is what our society needs? What seems to motivate many of these academic activists is not the welfare of children or the good of society, but their own selfish political goals and personal cravings. If we accept these innovative family arrangements as 21st century marriage, it will have long-term destructive effects on children and on our future. Liberals want us to abide by nature's laws when it comes to whales and the ice caps, but when it comes to the family, we're supposed to accept all sorts of rank innovations and radical revisions. I think this is folly. Stable marriages strengthen the foundation of our society, and it is in our public interest to protect their vitality. Even for those who reject the idea that God ordained the family in its traditional form, our decades of experimenting with the alternatives should be pretty good evidence that humans, by their unchanging nature, are most happy in the setting of a traditional family. If the family deconstructionists don't understand this, kids do. A study conducted by New America Media and the University of California Office of the President asked more than 600 young people ages 16 to 22 what they considered the most pressing issue facing their generation today. Their greatest concern? Family breakdown by 24%, topping the list. Sandy Close, the executive director overseeing the project, said rightly, that there is a deep yearning for traditional structures and values. With the central importance of family in mind, governments have been endorsing marriage and families for centuries. Unfortunately, today, too often government policies don't support families. Indeed, more often than not, government is the enemy. From a political perspective, Hillary Clinton's mantra that it takes a village to raise a child has been a masterstroke. The genius behind this phrase lies in its ambiguity. All of us recognize that rearing children is very difficult and that parents need help and support from the larger community. In fact, we want and expect community organizations, including the government, to help parents. Unfortunately, that's not what Hillary and her comrades have in mind when they talk about the village. Remember, cultural elites are not friendly to the traditional family. They think that instead of government helping families, government should, in many ways, replace families when it comes to dealing with children. Maybe Hillary meant to title her book, It Takes a Village Government. As a result, the proper relationship between families and government has been turned upside down. Government tries too hard to act as a parent while not doing enough to help parents. Let's consider each of these points in turn. The government makes a bad parent. Since the dawn of time, elites have sought to replace parents. Hundreds of years before Christ, Plato put forth the argument that children should be reared and educated by society as a whole, with no particular connection to their biological parents. In recent years, the United Nations Children's Fund, UNICEF, has promoted its Convention on the Rights of the Child, which would give children countless rights vis-a-vis their parents, including the right to receive information and ideas of all kinds, regardless of frontiers, either orally, in writing, or in print, in the form of art, or through any other media of the child's choice. Take that, you mothers trying to keep your kids off the internet. For the most part, we Americans have been fortunate to avoid any huge problems in this area, and most American parents still have the freedom to be parents. In fact, we haven't even approved UNICEF's silly convention. Nevertheless, the history of the U.S. welfare system provides a good example of why the government makes a bad parent. By the 1960s, one of the nation's most perceptive observers had noticed that government welfare programs had a dangerous side effect of weakening traditional families. In 1965, Daniel Patrick Moynihan, at the time working for the Department of Labor, issued a report critical of the effects of government programs on African American families. In particular, he observed that African American families in the inner city were crumbling, in part because the government was taking the place of fathers as the main breadwinner. He also pointed out that the lack of committed fathers contributed to a host of difficulties for these families. Despite Moynihan's unassailable report, the federal government would not rethink its approach to welfare for 30 years. The Moynihan report was roundly dismissed and the matter closed, except for one problem. Moynihan's predictions came true. A recent article on the subject noted that even after efforts to reform welfare in the 90s, the problems facing African American families are, in many ways, even more severe than they were in 1965. Almost 70% of African American children are born to single mothers. Those mothers are far more likely than married mothers to be poor, even after a post-welfare reform decline in child poverty. They are also more likely to pass that poverty onto their children. In other words, we are still suffering from the problems identified by the Moynihan Report more than 40 years ago. And the problems are nationwide. Illegitimacy rates among Caucasians and Hispanics are also disturbingly high. The Moynihan Report was written by a liberal, in the true sense of the word, who warned very clearly of the dangers of expecting government money to replace the many benefits that children receive from a strong two-parent family. We can argue, and we will continue to argue, about how much the government can and should do to help poor families. We should all agree, however, that in the future, government efforts will be designed to strengthen families, not to pretend that they don't matter. If we want the village to help the children, then we should insist that the village do everything it can to ensure that children are brought up in loving and ideally two-parent families. Other government screw-ups, taxes, and no-fault divorce. Given that strong families are so important to our country, you might assume that the tax code would be designed to benefit traditional families. Wrong. More often than not, the code actually undermines them. Consider the sad story of the alternative minimum tax, the AMT, which was originally designed to target wealthy households that had used deductions to avoid paying income tax. Unfortunately, because the AMT had not been indexed to inflation, it now affects many middle-class families. Indeed, a recent report argued that the AMT effectively penalizes families. AMT imposes penalties on marriage and having children. Couples will be more than 20 times as likely as singles to face the AMT in 2010. Because the AMT prohibits deductions for dependents, 85% of married couples with two or more children will face the AMT. 97% among such couples with income between $75,000 and $100,000. About 6 million taxpayers will face the AMT in 2010 simply because they have children. The village idiots continue to tax children. And though there are congressional proposals to exempt those making less than $250,000 a year from the AMT, with the Democrats running the show, expect to feel the tax bite elsewhere. The AMT is a travesty, and it should be scrapped for everyone, but especially for families. And what about increasing the child tax credit, eliminating income level restrictions on it, and making it permanent? We should encourage what is good. If the government needs to make up the difference, slap some additional taxes onto pornography. Use the code to discourage what is truly destructive and demeaning. But give parents a break. As painful as the AMT is, the estate tax is even more anti-family, both in theory and in application. Here's how it works. When you die, the IRS totals up your estate and taxes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.